إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كلام الله عز وجل وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد. Indeed, we begin by praising Allah Azza wa Jal. We praise Allah and we thank Allah. We seek Allah's help and we seek Allah's assistance in all of our affairs. Whomsoever Allah guides to this straight path, to this balanced deen, al-Islam, none can misguide. No money, no temptations can mislead them if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen and decided to guide an individual to that which is true and correct. But whomever Allah allows to go astray, whomever Allah allows to fall out of His mercy, although His mercy is vast, there is nothing and no one that could guide that individual if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has left them to stray and error upon themselves. Even if they were from among our relatives, whom have rights over us, our children, who we cherish, our spouses, whom we love. There is nothing that you or I can do to guide anyone or to ensure that we ourselves stay guided, except that we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for istiqamah, for steadfastness upon this religion, while receiving the trials and tribulations of this life. Indeed, the best of speech is the book of Allah, Al-Quran, and the best of guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the most evil of affairs is the innovations in the religion. Every single innovation is a going astray. No matter how many people are upon that bid'ah, no matter how much hasanat you believe you will acquire by performing it, no matter how many of your relatives back home are upon it, any innovation in the religion is a going astray, and anything that takes you away from the deen of al-Islam, from the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will eventually lead into Allah's punishment and into Allah's anger and into Allah's fire. And we ask for Allah's protection from that. My dear brothers and sisters, O you who believe, fear your Lord in the matters in which He should be feared. Fear Allah with your children. Fear Allah with your spouses. Fear Allah in your business. Fear Allah with your customers. Fear Allah with your neighbors. Fear Allah with every morsel of food you bring to your mouth to eat. Fear Allah with every cup of drink you bring to your lips to taste. And do not die except in full and complete submission in Islam. For were you to be raised up on the Day of Judgment, believing in a God other than Allah or along with Allah, were you to be raised up on the Day of Judgment, as we all will be, naked and uncircumcised, believing in a prophet or messenger after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Were you to be raised up on the day of judgment, about which there is no doubt, believing in a book or scroll or paper, any sort of revelation after the Quran, then certainly you will be from among the losers on the day of judgment. And woe to the losers on that day, for after it, there is no victory. There is no victory after it. My dear brothers and sisters, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said in an authentic tradition, "Inna Allah rafiqun yuhibbu rifq." That certainly Allah is rafiqun, He is gentle. "Yuhibbu rifq," and He loves gentleness in what? In salah, with our children, with our wives. With who? With what? "Inna Allah rafiqun yuhibbu rifqa fil amri kulli." Indeed, certainly Allah is gentle, and He loves gentleness in every single matter. In every single matter. "Fil amri kullihi," all of it. With our children, with our wives, with our neighbors, with our co-workers, with the non-Muslim, with the ummah as a general, when we are slaughtering, even when we argue, when we are calling the people to remember Allah. Allah is gentle, and He loves gentleness in every single matter and affair. My dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves gentleness. And so we as Muslims should strive with ourselves and fight with our nafs, with our egos, with the harshness that may be within us as a result of the way we were brought up. Some of us was brought up in a very harsh and tough manner. We have to fight with ourselves, maybe in the society that we are in that does not respect and that does not cherish gentleness. We must fight with ourselves to become gentle, or to become more gentle than what we think we are. Why? Because it is a characteristic that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. And I am sure that each and every person in this masjid desires to be from among those whom Allah loves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the believers in the Qur'an. From among the many descriptions He gives them, He says, "Muhammadur Rasulullah wal-ladhina ma'ahu ashiddan ala al-kuffari ra'ama'u baynahum." That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. And those who are with Him, His companions, those who believe in Him, they are stern with the non-Muslims. رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ. But they are so gentle with one another. They are so merciful with one another. And this ayah should not be misinterpreted. When Allah says they are stern with the non-Muslims, Allah is meaning that we are professional with them. We treat ourselves in a very professional manner. We are not overexerting ourselves to be extra kind to them, to be extra bearing for them. And negate our relationship with our Muslim brothers and sisters. Because when you examine the ummah today, you find that we are harsh with one another. Akhi, your pants. Sister, the hijab. Akhi, the beard. Akhi, da'wah, tawbah, salah. We have no patience. We have no gentleness when it comes to one another. But with the non-Muslims, we are ever gracious and ever gentle. We are so patient with them. We are so merciful with them. And this is the opposite of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes those who truly follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even when it comes with those who are oppressive, with those who are tyrants, to prove that this ayah is not saying that we are allowed to be harsh and stern and rude with the non-Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He sends Musa and Harun to go and to speak to Fir'aun, what did Allah command the two of them? فَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. And the both of you go to him and give Fir'aun a word that is layyinan, that is gentle, that is easy, that is soft, that is moderate. Why? He's a tyrant. Fir'aun has said, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. I am your highest lord. But Allah commands his prophet to go to this tyrant and speak to him in a gentle and kind way. لَعَلَّهُ. Perhaps he will يَتَذَكَّرُ. He will remember Allah's favors upon him. He will remember that he is just a human being. He will remember that he has gone overboard. أَوْ يَخْشَى. Or he will fear Allah. So speak with him gently. My dear brothers and sisters, when we look at the ummah today, we are failing when it results or as it relates to having gentleness with one another, having love and mutual respect for one another, being kind for one another. But that leads us to the khutbah today, for I have not even begun the khutbah yet. For this hour, on this Friday, the khutbah is regarding domestic violence. And what is domestic violence? It is violence against one spouse, whether male or female. But last month, the month of October, was Domestic Violence Month. Domestic Violence Awareness Month, in which a group, the National Coalition Against Domestic Violence, in October of 1981, made the month of October Domestic Violence Awareness Month, with one aim and one objective that I support: to end the violence against women and children. To end the violence against women and children. And I do not believe there is one Muslim who would disagree with that statement. And although a husband can be domestically abused, verbally or physically, the percentage of that occurring is small when compared to the domestic violence that our sisters receive from among the Muslim community and from outside of the Muslim community. The victimization of women in relationships and children is at a higher percentage than the domestic violence that occurs to men, although we are not disagreeing that it does occur. As an imam, I am not here to speak in general terms that all groups need to reevaluate the way that they are in a relationship with their husband and wife. But because I am a Muslim, I want to speak directly to the Muslim community about this issue. Because domestic violence is real, and it occurs within our community. Although we are not the only community to have it, it occurs within our community. And I want to put forth the answer for those who may be on the fence, for those who may not understand what Islam's position on hitting women or hitting our wives. What is the position and what is the ruling on this? I wanted to prepare something that was clear as day, so that we may know how to navigate our relationships when they fall into trouble. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us in the Quran and has given us some guidelines for what we as men should do when we are having problems with our wives. Allah gives us three guidelines, because if it was left to you and I to deal with our wives the way we feel how to deal with them, then definitely dhul and oppression would occur. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not left anything in this dunya except that He has given us some rules and regulations and some hidayah to it, even when using the bathroom. Akramakumullah. Allah has given us some guidance. So what does the Quran tell us when it comes to how we solve problems within a marriage, how we solve disputes? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the man three options. Allah says, فَعِذُوهُنَّ, advise them. Your wives. When you have a situation, advise them. وَهْجُرُوهُنَّ, boycott them, leave them off. Do not stay in their beds. وَضْرِبُوهُنَّ, or hit them. Before we open this topic, I ask you, this Quran that we have been given, has Allah sent it down for you and I to read and to judge and to interpret based upon what we feel? Or has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down a hikmah and a guidance to explain this Quran to us? Allah has given us Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and has preserved for us a sunnah by which we can understand the Quran properly. Because when you leave the people alone to judge for themselves, errors and mistakes occur. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. And certainly in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the excellent example. Is the excellent example for you as Muslims. One of the tabi'een came to our mother Aisha radiallahu anha and asked a very important question. He said, O mother of the believers, Ya Umm al-Mu'mineen, what was the character of the Prophet like? What was the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, have you not read the Quran? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَهُوَ عَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is upon a high standard of character. And then she further mentioned, وَخُلُقَهُ, and his character, Al-Quran, was the Quran, found in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. She said, have you not read the Quran? You're asking about his character? Allah has said about his character, it was the best. And furthermore, his character was the Quran. So if there was any individual or any sunnah that was preserved for us to follow, to understand the ayat found in the Quran, it would be from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what has Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam preserved for us to come to understand these three guidelines? Let's take them one by one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَعِذُوهُنَّ, advise them, admonish them. Has Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever admonished his wives or advised his wives? Yes, he has. From among the many traditions that I can bring you, I will bring one that is mashhoor, that is famous, that I think every single one of us knows and recognizes. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sleeping in the house of Aisha radiallahu anha, and in the middle of the night he got up out of his bed quietly, and he left the bed quietly, and then he went out of the house. Our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, she was awoken and thought to herself, maybe he has left my house to go to another wife's house. And so the jealousy came up in our mother. May Allah be pleased with her. And so she followed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until he reached Al-Baqir, the cemetery. And while he was standing there, he was making dua for the dead. Making dua in the middle of the night while everyone else is sleeping. He is outside by the graveyard making dua for the dead, for the shuhada. And when he had finished, he turned and started to go back home. Aisha began to walk home. The Prophet began to walk faster. Aisha began to walk faster. The Prophet began to run. Aisha began to run. And she gets in the house and jumps in the bed and covers herself. But what happens after you are running for a short period of time? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam enters the house and says, Ya Aisha, is everything okay with you? You're breathing heavily. Are you okay? Concern for his wife. She, yes, I'm okay. Yeah, Aisha, what happened? Because if you don't tell me, then the one above the seven heavens will tell me. And she said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I heard you get up in the middle of the night very quietly. And you left the house, and I thought maybe you left to go to another wife and to give my night to another wife. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet of mercy and rahmah, the one who has the ultimate akhlaq, became upset. Why? He said, Ya Aisha, do you think that the Prophet of Allah would deceive you? This night is for you. Do you think that a prophet is capable of deception? That I tell you this night is yours, but I give it to another? Our mother Aisha was hurt. She was upset. She was sad by this reaction of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was justified because it is not befitting a prophet to deceive the people. Rasulullah fa'idhuhunna. He admonished his wife Aisha radiallahu anha. He advised her. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wahjuruhunna, and forsake their beds, leave them off, boycott them. Has Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever boycotted his wife and left them off for a period of time? For those of you who have read the seerah, you would know that happened. Because of the difficulty of life in Medina and the shortness of provisions, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, she says that 2 full moons would pass, 2 months would pass by, and there would be no fire in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No fire means nothing is cooking, no roti, no biryani, nothing is being cooked in his house for 2 months. Some of us lose our cool when the wives don't have the food ready in 1 for 1 day, because she is busy doing your laundry. She is busy with your children. 2 months, no food in the house. And so, his wives are not angels, they are human beings. And so they began to complain and complain and complain. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, following the ayah, وَهْجُرُوهُنَّ, he boycotted them. He took himself away in a separate apartment and stayed away from them for an entire month and did not speak to any of his wives and did not visit any of his wives. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he mentions for us a hadith that I believe every single individual in here knows, but now we're going to make the connection. He said, I used to have an Ansari neighbor. I would go for knowledge, and he would work his farm and then work my farm. And then I would come back in the evening and we would stay up all night teaching each other what I had learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the next day I would work my farm and his farm, and he would go and sit with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam all day. And then he would return that night and we would stay up all night learning what he had just received. When did they sleep? And so Umar, he mentions, and one day that Ansari neighbor came back at night and said to me, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has divorced all of his wives. Umar became upset and worried. Why? Because his daughter Hafsa is married to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he left and he went to visit his daughter. Is it true that the Prophet has divorced all of you? She said, I don't know. No one has seen him. And then he went to go visit Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to discover that the Prophet had not divorced his wives, but it was a rumor. And just as rumors spread today, rumors had spread at that time. Allah told him to advise his wives. We have from the sunnah him advising his wives. Allah told him that if that doesn't work, then boycott them. We have from the sunnah the Prophet boycotting his wife for a month. But Allah continues and he says, if that doesn't work, وَضْرِبُوهُنَّ, then beat them. I ask you to think and to ponder. Do you know of any scenario or any hadith, even weak hadith, bring it forward, of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hitting any of his wives? أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله ما بعد. Dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the man three guidelines when it comes to dealing with his wives when he is having problems in his marriage. Legitimate problems. Not because the food is not good, not because the house is not clean. Legitimate problems in the marriage. And every marriage has problems. No marriage is free from problems. For if there was one marriage that would be free from problems, it would have been Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his wives. So this advice is for each and every one of us. And Allah orders the believers that you must first advise them of this problem. And if that doesn't work, then you should boycott them. And if that doesn't work, وَدْرِبُوهُنَّ then beat them. I ask you, before we explain وَدْرِبُوهُنَّ, because the word ضَرَبَ in the Arabic language, the verb, it means to hit and to strike. ضَرَبَ يَضْرِبُ, that's what it means linguistically. But we turn to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the explanation. But before we begin, I ask you, does it make sense, and no one answer but think, does it make sense that we divorce our wives first and then advise them? Does it make sense, and no one answer, just think, that we divorce our wives first and then forsake their beds, don't sleep with them in the bed, they're already divorced. So you understand that these three guidelines must occur before the divorce. Because these are the three guidelines you use to save the marriage from divorce. So now let us go to this ayah. وَدْرِبُوهُنَّ, and hit them. We know that after the boycott of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his wives, he gathered them all together and he offered them divorce. And he said, if you would like, I will divorce all of you and I will make sure that every single one of you is taken care of. I will give you a percentage of wealth to make sure that every single thing is taken care of for you for the rest of your life. Or if you choose, you can stay with me in this marriage and be patient and have Allah and His Messenger. The decision is yours. And every single one of them said, we want Allah and His Messenger, we will be patient. We want Allah and His Messenger, we will be patient. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam offered divorce and did not gather them all together to give them a royal beatdown. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not visit every house and beat the wives and then offer divorce. Rather, after admonishing them and after boycotting them, he offered them divorce. So this leads some of our scholars to say that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says وَدْرِبُوهُنَّ, and hit them and strike them, what it means is divorce them. Divorce them. Let me support that with three evidences. The first evidence being a hadith in which one of the companions, the son of Muqarrin, he saw a man chastising his slave and hitting his slave in the face. And he said, do you find no other place other than the face to hit your slave? I was one of the seven sons of Muqarrin radiallahu anhu. And the youngest from amongst us slapped our slave girl. And we only had one slave girl. We only had one slave girl. Seven sons. And the youngest from us slapped her in the face. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he discovered this, he said, "A'tiqha, free her because of that slap." Now, any of you who knows anything about the Islamic studies, you would know that the slave has half the right of the free woman. The slave has half the right of the free woman. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered the freeing of a slave because of a smack in her face, then what about a free woman? Second evidence. One of the companions, a sahabiya, her name was Fatima bin Qais, radiallahu anha. Her husband divorced her. And so she came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said, I've been divorced. Rasulullah said, go to the house of Abdullah bin Maktoum. He's a blind man, he cannot see you. Do your iddah there. And she did her iddah. And when you finish, come to see me. So she came back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, my iddah is over, who should I marry? But before she asked him, she said, I have received two proposals. One from Muawiyah ibn Abu Sufyan and one from Jahm. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, as for Muawiyah, he is broke. He's poor. So don't marry him. My dear brothers, young brothers, you need a job before you take on a wife. But that's another khutbah. He is poor, so don't marry him. And as for Jahm, his stick never leaves his shoulder. His stick never leaves his shoulder, so do not marry him. This, his stick never leaves his shoulder, is a kinaya in the Arabic language. It's a metaphor. But what does it mean? It has one of two meanings. The popular meaning is, his stick never leaves his shoulder, he beats his wives. So do not marry him. If beatings when wife is permissible in the deen, why would Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tell a woman not to marry him for doing that action? But I don't like that interpretation of his stick never leaves his shoulder. There is another meaning which I personally think is more correct. Because Musa alayhi salam, his stick also never left his shoulder. And so the Arabs would use this, that the stick never left the shoulder, to mean that this person is constantly traveling. His stick is on his shoulder. He is constantly traveling. Whoa. And so you shouldn't marry him because he'll never be home. My dear brothers and sisters, abandonment, when we abandon our wives, that is a form of domestic abuse. Domestic abuse is not only physical. Domestic abuse is verbal as well. Domestic abuse is also abandonment. Either way, whether you knew or understood the first or the two of the parables, of the metaphors, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised her not to get into that toxic relationship, rather to marry Usama ibn Zayd, and that is another khutbah on its own. Last but not least, because the time is getting by me, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. Maybe there are some of you who say, yeah, Imam, you don't know if the Prophet hit his wives or not. That's secret. That's in the house. He advised them. He boycotted them. Maybe he hit them and then he offered them divorce. Okay. I don't know the ghayb. But I do know a hadith from our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. And I believe the statement of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. In which she said, مَا دَرَبَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ خَادِمًا لَهُ وَلَا إِمْرَأَةً. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never hit a slave. وَلَا إِمْرَأَةً, and not even a woman or any of his wives. وَلَا دَرَبَ بِيَدِهِ شَيْئًا. He never hit anything with his hand, not even a child. Illa, except fi sabilillah, when he's on the front lines defending Islam. So my dear brothers and sisters, I would like for each and every one of you to revisit your own relationship and those of your spouses. The relationship you have with your wives, the relationship you have with your husband, the relationship you have with your children. Remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is gentle.
And he loves gentleness.
Remember that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the best example for us. And he never hit any of his wives. Never hit any of his slaves. Never even spanked a child. And remember, last but not least, the ayah which dictates how we should live with our spouse, whether how a husband should live with his wife or how a wife should live with her husband. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. And live with them kindly. Live with your wives kindly. Live with your spouse kindly. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us understanding. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from among those who will be gentle with the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah to forgive us for our sins and the mistakes and the harshness that we may have shown in our past. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from among those who will commit to being gentle and nice and merciful with all of the Muslims. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our sins, and we ask Allah to enter us into His paradise. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا آمَنَّا فَاغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. My dear brothers and sisters, before we leave, I have one announcement. There is a masjid that's going to be opening up in East Flatbush. They have bought a house in East Flatbush, East 43rd Street and Church Avenue. A masjid is desperately needed in that area, East 43rd Street and Church Avenue. And they're going to be standing outside seeking donations. The masjid has already been bought. We are trying to build, to renovate, to make it appropriate so that we may have a place to pray, so that that area, that community, my community, I live in that area, can have a place to pray. So for those of you who are able, be generous with the brothers outside as they are collecting. إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. واقم الصلاة.